Here come on, flat top, he come. Grooving up slowly, he got juju eyeball, he won. Holy roller, he got hair down to his knee. Got to be a joker, he just do what he please.
Gentlemen, it's with sad hearts that we're here to talk right now about the recent passing of Robin Williams. I don't even know where to begin with this, because when I heard about this, it was just like, what? This makes no sense at all.
I believe I told you about it.
Yes, that very true. Reto texted me last night and said Robin Williams had passed away. And I was like, what? What? Is this some sort of big joke for some horrible movie that he was doing? Because we had just seen him on the trailers for New Night at the Museum.
Yeah.
And it was...
We were pretty excited to go see that, actually.
Yeah, it's sort of surreal to me.
Yeah, we will.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. But it's really, really surreal to me. I mean...
Yeah, when I first heard about it, I saw it on Facebook. And let's face it, you know, there are some pranksters out there who use, oh, so-and-so died, and then you go on Google, and then, no, it was just a prank, it was just a hoax.
Yeah.
And then this, when I actually Googled this, I was like, wait, this is legit.
To be honest to me, I have to say I was damn shocked, because I remember hearing, like, years ago about him going into rehab and getting help for alcoholism and other problems that he was having, and the fact that he actually managed to turn that around. I mean, didn't he recently even go to Philip Seymour Hoffman's funeral or something like that? I mean, I know...
I don't remember.
I don't know if he did or not, but I know that, like, it's just surprising.
Mind-blowing.
Yeah, it is.
Especially from what you saw of him in the last couple times, he seemed normal. He seemed like his old self. And this happens, and you find out he wasn't his old self.
No, there was so much going on. And in fact, they were actually talking about, well, apparently they officially now canceled
the crazy ones,
but there were, like, maybe some talks about bringing it back mid-season. So, you know, it's just like...
And he had three other movies lined up.
Including Mrs. Doubtfire 2. So the question was, what, I guess, in my mind, what the heck possessed this for him to do this?
He was very sad. Let's just leave it at that, because we don't know the extensive details about what happened and what goes through a mind when someone is very depressed.
Well, I know you watch The Talk With Me sometimes.
Yes, I do.
And Cheryl Underwood mentioned, she's a comedian, technically, and one of the things that she mentioned at the time, they were talking about an issue that happened to George Lopez, where he got so drunk that he passed out in the middle of
a bar
or
a hotel. Yeah.
Yeah, and everyone was just like shocked, like, what? He's this hilariously funny guy, you know, why in the world would this happen? And apparently, according to her, a lot of comedians suffer from addiction and depression and a lot of problems. And so apparently it's pretty damn common with comedians to be stressed and really upset about things. What's happening this year? Why is there so much of this going on? This whole thing about why people might come off as really funny when they're not. In a lot of cases, they start hating themselves. They'll be bullied or picked on or, you know, invisible to people. And at some point, they realize that if they can make people laugh at them or with them instead of at them, you know, they can kind of put up a wall, and that wall becomes their deterrent. It's actually a way to keep people away from you. So, Curly Q, Reto, thoughts, anything?
Just an overwhelming sense of sadness, really. I really can't think of anything because, surprisingly, I think maybe a day or two ago, I was thinking of actually rewatching Aladdin. That's kind of ironic now, but yeah, I really have not much to say. I just sadness.
Reto?
Yeah, I agree with Curly Hugh. Not too long ago, when was it? Sunday. I was at a bookstore and I saw, like, Mrs. Doubtfire on the DVD rack, and I was like, maybe I should get it. But by the time I got back, it was gone.
Aw.
Yeah. I'm still trying to, like, process it. It's like, you know.
Like, what the hell?
I'm sure, you know, it makes sense, but at this point, it's like, I can't, you know.
One of the things that people were talking about is that the sheriff kind of released a lot of details in regard to his passing, and people we're not, but
you can find that on your own.
Yeah, the thing is that people were actually angry about this. There's like this huge mix of either half the people are like really upset because his wife requested that the whole family got to have privacy, and this apparently pretty much invalidated that.
Actually, no, about that, what happened was she asked for privacy while they were mourning, and yet the same news people that decided to air this had a chopper over their house.
Jesus Christ.
That's horrible.
Jesus Christ. Yes, I get that he's a public figure, but for me, it's really weird because you don't see this.
We forget they're human.
Yeah, you don't get this with, like, Broadway actors. Like, you never hear about, you know, Broadway. I mean, you hear sometimes about Broadway actors not getting a lot of privacy, but it's, like, not as heavy. Unfortunately, we will probably never know what went through his mind or why he did what he did, and that's the tragedy of it. One thing for sure that I can think of is, you know, what do we do when someone you know or care about has these problems? I mean, how do you deal with that?
Talk, counseling, contact the suicide hotline, the national one.
What's that number?
1-800-273-TALK, T-A-L-K, or 1-800-273-8255.
And this number is really important. I mean, people should absolutely.
People don't know about it, which is a sad thing.
Yeah. Someone says that they're in this dark place. You have to talk to them.
And if you can't help them, you contact someone who can.
Exactly.
And I would say if it's too overwhelming for you, like if you're a younger person.
And don't try to yell at them.
No, yelling at them does not help anything. And don't say, oh, cheer up, or other things. Listen to them. For God's sakes, just listen to them.
If they need to vent, let them vent.
And don't get upset if they're not, like, if they're one of the funny types where they're, like, always joking. Don't get upset at them if they're not joking about things, you know? They're going through trouble, and they're reaching out to you. If they're able to drop the mask around you, then consider yourself very lucky because they trust you enough to actually talk to you about their and show you their more serious side. So, what did you guys think about his work? What do you guys feel about Robin Williams' work? Like, what was your favorite? What was your favorite movie or
that he did? How about
you, Reto? Actually, I kind of like his stand-up routines. They're pretty funny. It was like one of those, like, where you cannot watch it if you're eating, drinking, whatever, because you will choke on something and die of laughter.
It is.
It was, really.
What was it? Someone, there was a comment from he did work for the USO. Like, that was one of his bigger things. And there was two comments that stick in my mind. One was an Army officer saying that he had gotten one of Robin Williams' earlier
albums,
and he said it was one of his favorite things, And Robin Williams grabbed this guy's camera, tossed it to the nearest person, jumped in this guy's arms, and gave him a big hug.
To take a picture.
And I was just like, wow. That was damn awesome of him. And I'm pretty damn sure he appreciated it. Because that was his livelihood. What was the other commentary? Another one was, there was him and two other celebrities, they flew into Afghanistan, and he literally got out of the chopper where, this was an area where it was considered very dangerous. He jumped out of the chopper and was doing a stand-up routine in the mortar pit where the guys were with the giant rockets shooting off. And the other two celebrities were too scared to jump down, and he just got out and, you know, started doing his bit. And I'm like, damn, the dude, he had some balls, man, because you don't know if someone's going to start shooting or not. Me? Wow.
Favorite role.
To be honest, and I know a lot of people are going to probably say this is pretty common, but it was Genie from Aladdin. And for a very personal reason is at the time when Aladdin came out, I had a very, very bad flu. My family and I didn't know what it really was. We had gone to see Aladdin back in Thanksgiving. And I remember my dad, he was busting out laughing during the entire movie. It was like everyone in the theater was laughing. And it wasn't just the little kids from the, you know, goofy moments, but it was the adults, like the random impressions that he was doing that we as children couldn't get. And the thing I remember is the whole "made you look," my dad cracked up so hard. He was almost peeing his pants. So fast forward towards the end of November, I get this really bad cold. And in December, I got Genie. I got my stuffed Genie, which was, you know, an awesome stuffed toy that Disney put out of... I have two, actually. I have the soft plush one where you can stuff him in a lamp, and then I have this big plushy Genie that has bendable arms and stuff. And I remember this Genie giving me comfort the whole time because I kept thinking of Robin Williams' voice in my head whenever I was, like, hugging and cuddling with the Genie. And it helped me get through the whole illness, which lasted until January, and finally it cleared up because the doctors figured out, it's a really bad case of the flu after taking, like, several blood tests, which really sucked. But it became a movie that, to me, symbolized everything good about Disney at the time. And I really love that character. And it's a character that I appreciated beyond belief. It's the thing that kept me coming back and wanting to, you know, watch that movie over and over and over and over. And I would say, happily enough, Popeye. Popeye was one of the first roles I saw him in. Which is really weird because most people would say they saw him in different characters, but his first role I saw him in is Popeye, and I saw parts of Good Morning Vietnam. I don't know if I remember finishing that whole thing, because it was kind of depressing at points, but it was the first time I really figured out who Robin Williams was. So that was my little story. Curly Q.
It's kind of funny to say this. I know a lot of people like say Genie or Mrs. Doubtfire. Surprisingly, I think one of the roles that really left an impact on me and that I really liked was his role in Jumanji.
Yeah, that was...
I think because as a kid, to me, when he came back from the game, I know it's kind of... Spoilers for Jumanji, but it's an older movie now, so most people have probably seen it, but... The determination of his character just, I don't know, really spoke to me as a kid. And while I love Genie, it just, I don't know, it just really was really awesome and was really fun. And yeah.
He actually, I think, made that movie one of, like, the few times I could say he was really interesting. Like, he actually, it was one of the more serious roles he played, but he still managed to pull comedy in it. I mean, there was, like, a dark undertone to that thing, but I think that he wasn't completely wacky, but he wasn't, you know, uber serious in it. So, yeah. Any other thoughts, Reto?
I am looking for Aladdin on Netflix, and bastards haven't put it up yet.
Netflix!
Yeah, Pocahontas, Hercules, but no Aladdin. What the ever-loving fuck, Netflix?
I know. It's one of the reasons I don't particularly like Netflix. It's like, I can't get my movies. Give me my movies.
We might spend the weekend watching Jumanji and Aladdin and The King of Thieves and stuff.
Oh, they
like
have
that.
Jumanji here. And some other things, too.
I know Mrs. Doubtfire is going to be rented out, yeah. So.
I'm wondering, do you guys think that Night of the Museum 3 is going to do better box office than possibly originally predicted?
Yes.
Yeah.
Probably.
Probably, like, I guess, just to see his final performance.
And he said he liked that role, so.
So, I'm not really sure what else to add to this. Any other thoughts or any last-minute commentary?
In general?
Yeah.
Well, you know, if you see someone talking, even if they're just joking about, you know, oh, hey, I'm going to kill myself, either trying to kill themselves or talking about, like, being in so much pain or, you know, that trapped feeling.
Yes.
Or, you know, including they use an insane amount of alcohol, drugs. It's pretty much, like, educate yourselves about warnings of suicide, and even if they're early, just, you know, talk to them every, you know, just try to talk to them. It's, yeah, it's hard, but if you can't, pretty much to those who have these dark thoughts, you know, you're not alone. Suicide is just a permanent solution to a temporary problem. Every problem can be solved. Suicide is just the moment. Think about in the future, you know, who's going to walk my dog. I had plans to meet up with my friends for a movie and on Sunday or something like that. Think about that.
Yeah.
Because you're just going to disappoint all those other people you who actually cared about you.
Yeah.
And think about it this way. I'm not trying to make them feel bad or even their friends. It's like, how do you think your friends, your family would feel knowing that you were suffering this much and they could have helped you, you know? They would have had to live with that guilt.
Yes.
So, you know, if you or someone you know is thinking, you know, those dark thoughts, having suicidal thoughts, please, please, please call 1-800-273-8255. That number is 24/7 and it is strictly confidential. Or you could go to suicidepreventionlifeline.org.
Like she said, just remember, talk to them, even if you have to stay up really, really late, and, you know, talk to them till morning. Talk to them. You can, technically, I think you can call an ambulance in your area and get them to contact the police response unit in that state or in that zone, because technically 911 covers the United States, so if you do know someone that is, you know, endangering themselves in any way, shape, or form, you can call the police in your area and have them contact the paramedics in that state. There are ways
what
for them
to know. Ellen's trying to say is, say if she was, we live in the same city, but let's just, for example, say she was in San Francisco and I'm in New York, and I knew she had these suicidal tendencies. I can contact the San Francisco Police Department, whatever district, and they would send help
right
to her.
And that's by calling,
that's what she,
I believe it's by calling your own 911 emergency number and just saying, hey, I'm online with my friend. They're talking about committing suicide. Could you please, you know, contact the San Francisco Police Department and have them go, here's their address, here's their phone number. You know, please have them go to this house and, you know, help my friend. She could be in serious trouble. It would be a good idea to contact your local fire department and or police to ask them how this can be done. So in case, if you do know someone who is suicidal, you do know how to contact them that way to get to the paramedics and stuff. And the hotline will also do so. If they will call the person themselves. You can ask them to call the person's house and have them talk to the person that's having this problem. So, one more time, Reto, what's that number?
Hold on. I'm trying to pull it up. It's, work with me, phone. 1-800-273-8255. 1-800-273-TALK. Or the suicidepreventionlifeline.org.
Is there any way we can close this out now?
Again, let's not remember him for how he died, but remember the good times.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Also remember, I guess, like, this is an eye-opener to people with depression or people who know other people who have depression, mm-hmm. that this can affect, like, anybody, and we mean anybody.
I would like to add, please, please, please keep him in your thoughts, his family too, as well as please try and be mindful of their Twitter accounts. Leave good messages for him and his family if you do go on his Twitter.
Not be assholes.
Yeah, don't be...
There were a couple.
Don't be horrible about this, because his kids are going through hell. And
especially his daughter.
His daughter, his two sons, his adopted sons, I mean, and his wife and his former wives, who are all still with us. So if you feel the need to express your like of his work, you know, please do so in a
respectful
manner to the families, and please at least adhere to his wife's request of minding their privacy and stuff. Anything else to add? You don't have anything else to add? Curly Q?
You
guys said perfectly.
Just, you know, to the earliest comedian we all knew.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. To the earliest comedian we all knew, to, let's face it, the biggest Zelda fan. he named his girl after Zelda.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And to the, I guess, you could call him like a geek. He was one of us.
Yeah, he was.
We will miss him. We lost someone good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He was loved very much.
And I don't think there's going to be anyone who's going to be able to make as big of an impact as he did in the comedian, in the comic world.
Mm-hmm.
So just remember him in good ways, and hopefully
watch some Dead Poets Society.
And Aladdin, and Patch Adams, and watch
Jumanji.
And Jumanji, yes.
And Mrs. Doubtfire, the dad had some of the funniest.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Yes. I can't think of anything else to add, so I guess for the Lilium Henryi, this has been Elle.
Curly Q.
And Reto.
Wishing you all a good night and a peaceful morning.
Again, the number is 1-800-273-TALK, 1-800-273-8255.
Here, roller coaster, he got early warning. Together!